Welcome. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our lecturer, our speaker tonight, Dr. Ewan Goliger, who is an intensive care physician and researcher here in Toronto. After studying biochemistry and medicine at the University of British Columbia, he trained in internal medicine and intensive care medicine at the University of Toronto. He now practices in Toronto, where he recently completed his doctoral degree in physiology at this university. Dr. Goliger's research focuses on the effects of mechanical ventilation on human lung and respiratory muscle function and the consequences for patient outcomes. An author of over 30 peer-reviewed papers, he has also written on the issues of euthanasia and conscientious objection, both in academic journals and for newspapers. So I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Goliger this evening to deliver the DeVeber Institute for Bioethics annual public lecture.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Gentles, for the warm welcome. Thank you to the DeVeber Institute for the invitation to give this lecture, and to our hosts, Wycliffe College, for their hospitality and the use of this beautiful hall. I want to thank each of you in the audience for your interest in the matter before us this evening, the ethics of conscientious objection in medicine. Preparation for this lecture has afforded me the opportunity to systematically consider the many challenging ethical considerations engaged by this complex issue. I think it's important to begin with full disclosure. I am neither a clinical ethicist nor a trained moral philosopher. My limited academic expertise lies in the beautiful science of physiology. I am here this evening simply because I am a doctor working in the trenches of patient care, confronted by a range of moral dilemmas in end-of-life care. Motivated by the desire to ground my medical practice in the very best of reason and virtue, I have read widely and studied to the best of my ability as much of the relevant literature as I can. In my research for this lecture, I am indebted to the work of Tristram Engelhart, Mark Wyclair, Daniel Sulmasy, Edmund Pellegrino, Loris Kaljan, Wayne Sumner, and others. I'm also grateful to Udo Shuklenk and Julian Savulescu for presenting their arguments against conscientious objection in written form for scrutiny and evaluation. Wrestling with their arguments has greatly helped me to refine and develop my case for conscientious objection. This evening, I want to share with you what I've learned thus far, and I welcome your thoughts and critiques. The views expressed in this lecture are my own, and I do not purport to represent any of the institutions with which I'm privileged to be affiliated. Let's begin with a fictional illustrative case. Suppose that you're a neurologist with long training in the diagnosis and management of diseases of the nervous system. You are caring for a young woman with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. The patient's condition is advanced and she is now essentially immobile. She can still swallow her food, but given the progression of her disease, there may soon be difficulties on that front. One day she presents to your clinic and advises you that she has made up her mind that it is time to die. She doesn't want to face further disease progression and fears what the future holds for her. She requests that you help her end her life. Please note that although this kind of request is variously referred to as medical aid in dying, physician-assisted death, physician-hastened death, or mercy killing even, I will simply refer to it as euthanasia for the sake of economy of words without necessarily meaning anything intrinsically pejorative by that term. Euthanasia, after all, simply refers to the idea of a good death, something we universally desire. Now, returning to our case, let us suppose that you are opposed morally to euthanasia. Perhaps this is because you are deeply troubled by the idea of causing death in your role as a physician. Perhaps you believe that such actions do not fall within the domain of medical practice. Or perhaps you are a committed religious believer, holding the conviction that to kill the patient or to be complicit in any way in the killing of the patient is a profane act of defiance against the Creator God whom you love and serve. The question before us is whether your ethical objection to providing a legally available intervention accepted by many in your profession should be honored over against the wishes of your patient. So what exactly is meant by the term conscientious objection? The term generally refers to circumstances where a physician expresses a moral objection to providing a legally, professionally accepted, and otherwise available medical service. A physician's objection is termed conscientious just in case it is grounded in an ethical judgment about the morality of the intervention rather than a medical judgment about the effectiveness of the intervention. Physicians often decline patient requests for therapy, generally on the grounds that the requested treatment isn't going to have an outcome that both patient and physician desire. A refusal based on conscience arises from the physician's judgment that the outcome desired by the patient is technically attainable, but morally unacceptable. Objection of this type has a long and fascinating history. Conscientious objecting to accepting certain religious beliefs has often grounds for martyrdom in bygone eras and still is in many places throughout the world. In the modern era, conscientious objection has generally arisen in the context of military participation and conscription. Objection is often, but not always, related to religious belief. For example, the renowned atheist Bertrand Russell spent time in prison during World War I for his pacifism and refusal to obey the draft order. The American ethicist Mark Wyclair records that language related to conscientious objection did not appear in medical codes of ethics until the legalization of abortion in the 1970s. This, for the first time, constituted a serious rift in the shared vision of morality held by the medical community, and many physicians felt that abortion, though legalized by a decision of the Supreme Court, remained outside the bounds of acceptable medical practice, purely on ethical grounds. Thus, they became conscientious objectors, and codes of ethics and statutes governing medical practice were widely amended at the time to protect this right of refusal. Today, some physicians, including myself, find ourselves in a similar circumstance. A historically controversial action, euthanasia, has been legalized by a momentous decision of the Supreme Court. In the wake of this decision, many voices outside medicine contend that euthanasia ought to be within the bounds of acceptable medical practice. Many physicians in Canada seem to have accepted this claim, although only a minority are actually willing to provide it. Those of us who remain opposed to something that would have been unthinkable for most physicians only a few years ago now find ourselves in the difficult position of the conscientious objector. The difficulty of this position has been dramatically amplified by the expectation that the physician provide an effective referral for procedures to which they object on the grounds of conscience. The robust protection of conscience provided for physicians following the legalization of abortion has not materialized with the legalization of euthanasia. Indeed, freedom of conscience in the practice of medicine has been seriously eroded in recent years. So the question before us this evening is whether conscientious objection merits respect. I will endeavor to present the case against objection fully and fairly. I will then attempt to respond to this case by exploring the basic moral framework for medical ethics and consider whether objections may sometimes be justified in light of this framework. My focus is going to be on the issue of euthanasia, though the general moral analysis we will develop may be applied much more broadly. Although I will be speaking to these issues from the vantage point of the physician, this analysis applies to all the caring professions that involve a covenantal commitment to patients. I will defend the thesis that conscientious objection is justifiable under certain conditions, and that our foundational beliefs about what is ultimately real and ultimately good have an inescapable influence on the professional decision-making of all physicians in these matters. So let's begin by summarizing the case against conscientious objection. Queen's University ethicist Udo Schoeklenk and Oxford University ethicist Julian Savulescu are two prominent opponents of objection. Writing in the Journal of Medical Ethics this year, Dr. Schoeklenk argues that medical professionals are not entitled to subvert the objectives of the profession they voluntarily joined by prioritizing their private beliefs over the professional delivery of services to the public, especially when they are monopoly purveyors of those services. The concern here is that patient care is constrained by the physician's moral beliefs rather than by professional and social consensus about acceptable medical practice. This is thought to be problematic for several reasons. First, it appears to put the physician's personal interests ahead of the patient's, something that seems incompatible with the spirit in which medical care is to be conducted. Writing in the New England Journal of Medicine, UCLA Professor of Law Julie Cantor argues that conscientious objection should be restricted because medicine needs to embrace a brand of professionalism that demands less self-interest, not more. Doctors have an obligation to care for the patient. Insofar as conscientious objection fails to care for the patient's interests and needs, it cannot be justified. Second, the imposition of the physician's moral beliefs on the patient is thought to be problematic because it takes advantage of the power imbalance innate to the relationship between physician and patient. There are important asymmetries in this relationship. Patients have medical problems that threaten their well-being. Doctors do not. Patients have limited knowledge and skill in medical matters, whereas doctors possess immense knowledge by virtue of years of education, training, and practice. Doctors function as gatekeepers to the healthcare system, a complex system of referral and services that patients cannot easily navigate on their own. Thus, the patient needs the doctor in a way that the doctor does not need the patient. This relationship functions only because patients believe that they can trust the doctor to act in their best interests, and they have little recourse if the physician refuses to do so. Alta Caro, a professor of law at the University of Wisconsin, argues that, quote, claiming an unfettered right to personal autonomy while holding monopolistic control over a public good constitutes an abuse of the public trust, close quote. Thus, the conscientiously objecting physician is said to betray the trust placed in her by leveraging the power imbalance in the physician-patient relationship to protect her moral integrity at the expense of the patient's interests. Conscientious objection also potentially violates professional obligations. Professor Caro characterizes conscientious objection as a refusal to deliver medical care. According to this line of reasoning, in assuming the privileges and responsibilities of medical practice, doctors commit to providing the full range of treatment options afforded to patients by their medical discipline. Julian Savulescu writes, quote, if people are not prepared to offer legally permitted, efficient and beneficial care to a patient because it conflicts with their values, they should not be doctors. Doctors should not offer partial medical services or partially discharge their obligations to care for their patients, close quote. Thus, conscientious objection is widely conceived of as a struggle to reconcile one's personal moral beliefs with one's professional obligations. A recent CBC documentary entitled The Road to Mercy characterized an Edmonton neurologist's conscientious objection to euthanasia in exactly this way. The website on the CBC said, quote, John's neurologist at the ALS clinic in Edmonton, Dr. Wendy Johnston, respects his desire for physician-assisted death, but feels she cannot personally offer it. She struggles to balance her professional duty to her patients and her medical code of ethics, close quote. This statement implies that Dr. Johnston's ethical beliefs are conflicting with her professional obligations. Conscientious objection potentially introduces inequities into the healthcare system. If conscientious objections are permitted in medical practice, the care that patients receive will depend on the values of their physician, and this is held to be an unjust inequity in healthcare. Savulescu writes, quote, the service that patients receive depends on the values of the treating doctor. Not only does this imply that patients must shop among doctors to receive the service to which they are entitled, introducing inefficiency and wasting resources, it also means that some patients, less informed of their entitlements, will fail to receive a service they should have received, close quote. Thus, conscientious objection seemingly interferes with medicine's commitment to social justice. The fourth and final major objection to conscientious objection touches on the controversial matter of the role of religion in the public square. There is no place, it is argued, for religious belief to influence the medical decisions of physicians. In other words, doctors may not appeal to religious authorities or texts in explaining that they will not offer a particular service. Religion is not permitted to define the bounds of acceptable medical practice. Two basic reasons are given for this contention. First, opponents of objection argue that doctors function more like public servants than private individuals. It is all well and good to permit individuals to live according to their faith beliefs insofar as those decisions affect only themselves in matters of private concern. Once, however, one dons the white coat and accepts the professional obligations of medicine and the responsibility of caring for others, one's private religious beliefs ought not to play an active guiding role. This is held to be an unwelcome intrusion of religion into the public square, a violation of the objectivity and selflessness required of a good doctor. A second and much deeper reason is also given against the role of religious belief in physician decision making. Religion, it is argued, is not rational. Religious beliefs are private convictions held arbitrarily without reference to reason. Religious belief is essentially adherence to superstition. Viewed in this light, it is hard to conceive of how a responsible physician can cite religious belief as a basis for refusing medical services. Medicine is an intellectual discipline founded upon reason and evidence. Insofar as religious belief has nothing to do with reason and evidence, it must play no role in the practice of medicine. Thus, Savulescu and Shuklenk write, "Individual moral judgments about the rights and wrongs of particular medical practices are by necessity partly arbitrary. They are arbitrary in the sense that their moral basis cannot be conclusively evaluated for soundness, an impossibility when it comes to religious convictions, for instance." Close quote. Elsewhere, in his argument against conscientious objection, Dr. Shuklenk quotes Adele Mercier as writing, quote, "Religion is all about believing that one's beliefs are right, but not about having right beliefs. If first-order religious beliefs had content, their content could be checked against the truth. It is precisely because such beliefs lack content that one can go on about believing that one believes them despite any and every evidence." Close quote. Thus, skepticism about the rationality of religious belief seems to contribute significantly to opposition to objection. This connection seems natural in that many cases of conscientious objection are in fact related to physicians' religious beliefs, although not necessarily. So to sum up, we have identified four reasons against objection. First, it selfishly imposes the doctor's personal values on patients. It's said to violate professional obligations to provide medical care. Third, it's said to give rise to inequities in the delivery of medical care. And fourth, it is frequently grounded in religious belief. Such beliefs are viewed as arbitrary, untestable, and possibly even harmful. As such, they cannot be permitted to influence the decisions of medical professionals. These are challenging and important objections that merit our close attention. So we turn now, in light of those objections, to make the case for conscientious objection over and against these objections cited above. In so doing, we need to consider the general role of conscience in medical practice. So what is conscience exactly? This question has no automatic, straightforward answer. Some see conscience as a kind of independent cognitive faculty fitted with apparatus that enables us to discern right from wrong. Accordingly, one might say, "My conscience tells me that I ought not to do such and such." Others use the term to refer to the exercise of moral discernment. Still others refer to conscience as the motivation to be good. The University of Chicago ethicist and physician Daniel Sulmasy describes conscience as a conjunction of will and judgment. On this view, conscience connects our belief in the goodness of certain acts to our will to act upon that belief. An illustration might be in order. Suppose that you attend a photography exhibit. The first portion of the exhibit is a series of photographs of city skylines from around the globe. You're impressed by the stark beauty of these photos, the contrast of city with surrounding nature skillfully captured by the photographers. The aesthetic quality of these photos is impressive and pleasing. Now suppose that you move on to the second portion of the exhibit, a series of photographs of the ravaged city of Aleppo. You see the bloodied faces of small children, the bombed out buildings, the all too obvious signs of hunger and malnutrition. The photos are characterized by the same aesthetic skill, the use of light and contrast and visual appeal. When you leave the exhibit, which set of photos are likely to move you to action? Both sets may be affirmed as good in terms of their aesthetic quality, yet it is the moral quality of the second set of photos that compels us to do something, to speak out, to write a letter, to sponsor a refugee. The data presented in the latter group of photos invoke a moral judgment, and that moral judgment moves us to act in a way that an aesthetic judgment does not. I think that conscience can simply be understood as the way in which moral beliefs move us to action. This is what is meant by a conjunction of will and judgment. When we form moral beliefs, we cannot help but feel compelled to act upon them, and this is the work of conscience. What then does conscience have to do with medical practice? In fact, the conscience is continuously engaged in the practice of medicine because every action of the physician carries moral significance. The physician is expected to do good for the patient. Thus, every judgment, even the most technical of judgments, are subject to moral evaluation. Medical practice is innately and unavoidably moral because of its regard for the patient's intrinsic and incalculable value, and because of the covenant of trust into which physicians enter with their patients. So let us consider the structure of medical morality. First, medicine derives its moral greatness from the value of the patient. If the patient were of little or no intrinsic value, medicine would lose its moral significance. Thus, the belief that medical care is a moral good is predicated on the belief that the patient is worthy of high esteem and special care. The patient is not to be regarded as a mere artifact of intellectual or scientific interest, something to be studied and explored and examined. Rather, the patient is to be honored, treated with respect and care, patience and kindness. The philosopher Immanuel Kant insightfully explained the essential nature of respect for persons by stipulating that persons must always be treated as ends rather than as means to ends. Medicine must not regard the well-being of the patient as a means to an end, but rather as an end in itself. Thus, medicine is innately moral because patients must be treated in a certain way, consistent with treating them as ends rather than as means. The patient's intrinsic moral worth becomes an essential guidepost for the conscientious physician. Medicine is also innately and unavoidably moral because of the nature of the relationship between physician and patient. Edmund Pellegrino and Daniel Sulmasy describe the essence of this relationship beautifully. They write, "When patients seek help, they are anxious, often in pain, fearful, dependent, and therefore vulnerable and exploitable. In that state, physicians ask them, 'How can I help you?' By that act, physicians invite the patient's confidence and trust that they are competent and will use that competence primarily in the patient's interests. The relationship is therefore not a contract, but a covenant of trust, to which physicians must be faithful, even if it means some suppression of self-interest. The good of the patient is thus a moral compass. In undertaking to care for the patient, we make a promise to help. And thus, all of medical practice is subject to moral evaluation in light of our faithfulness to that promise. In a classic exposition of the patient-physician covenant, published in the Journal of the American Medical Association, Ralph Croshaw and colleagues write that, quote, "Medicine is at its center a moral enterprise grounded in a covenant of trust. This covenant obliges physicians to be competent and to use their competence in the patient's best interests. Physicians, therefore, are both intellectually and morally obliged to act as advocates for the sick wherever their welfare is threatened and for their health at all times." Close quote. It's interesting to know that under this covenant, even the technical competence of physicians is a matter of ethical concern. Physicians owe it to their patients to be good at what they do. Accordingly, their competence is subject to both technical and moral evaluation. Thus, the professional judgments and actions of a physician cannot be divorced from her moral judgment. This covenant of trust between patient and physician constitutes another essential guidepost for the conscience of the physician. These foundations of medical ethics, the worth of the patient, and the covenant of trust between patient and physician, give rise to certain broad but essential ethical features of good medical practice. First, medicine must be practiced with a view to achieving a certain goal. Second, medicine must be practiced in accordance with certain virtues. First, consider the goals of medicine. Every prospective medical student struggles to prepare for the inevitable question in their interview for admission to medical school. Tell us, why do you want to be a doctor? How is one to avoid giving the universal answer, because I want to help people? On the one hand, it sounds cliche and therefore potentially insincere. On the other hand, that's exactly what medicine is for. The goal of medicine is to help the patient, to advance the patient's interests, and to do them good. The World Health Organization defines health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. Achieving this state of well-being is therefore the lofty goal at which we aim as physicians. Philosophers have made careful and thoughtful attempts to expand on this basic notion to specify more precisely the goals, the ways in which physicians are to help the patient. A consensus statement issued by the Hastings Center identified four goals: the prevention of disease and injury and the promotion of maintenance and of health, the relief of pain and suffering caused by maladies, the care and cure of those with a malady, and the care of those who cannot be cured, the avoidance of a premature death, and the pursuit of a peaceful death. These goals form the basis for the physician's professional obligations. We expect doctors always to act in accordance with these goals. Now let's consider the virtues of medical practice. These virtues relate to the notion that the goals of medicine cannot be pursued in just any manner deemed effective, that the ends of medicine do not justify any means of achieving those ends. So, for example, doctors ought not to employ deception as a means of achieving the goals of medicine. We're not to give placebos or lie to patients about our intentions or actions. We're not to coerce or force patients to cooperate with our treatment plans, except in rare circumstances where patients have lost the capacity for decision making. We're not to have sexual relations with a patient, even if the patient consents and seeks such relations. Such actions are forbidden because they devalue the patient. They treat patients as a means to an end rather than as ends in themselves. The virtuous physician practices with diligence, attention to detail, kindness, mercy, altruism, trustworthiness, and self-sacrifice. The virtuous physician respects the patient as an autonomous moral agent, a fundamental feature of the patient's moral significance, and seeks to empower the patient to advance her health-related interests. These virtues are essential to medical practice because they reflect the worth and significance of the patient with whom the physician has entered into a covenant of trust. Thus, the physician is professionally obligated to act in accordance with these virtues. So to summarize, we've seen that the high view of the patient is essential to medicine, and the covenant of trust between physician and patient give rise to the goals and virtues of medicine. These goals and virtues in turn define the professional obligations of the physician. Physicians are obliged to act for the patient's interest because doing so is the very point of medicine. Physicians are obliged to strive for the highest level of competency because of the covenant of trust between patient and physician. Thus, professional obligations do not appear arbitrarily and out of nowhere. Rather, they derive from the moral significance of the patient and the special nature of the relationship between patient and physician. Conscience enters this equation as the conjunction of will and judgment. Accepting the profound ethical obligations owing to the patient, the physician is moved by conscience to fulfill these obligations to the very best of his ability. For this reason, the Declaration of Geneva, a medical oath ratified by the World Medical Association, among other things, calls upon physicians to act with conscience and dignity, to dedicate themselves to the service of humanity, and to make the health of their patients their first consideration. The conscientious physician manifests an unswerving commitment to one's professional obligations to advance the goals of medicine in a manner consistent with the virtues of medicine. This commitment is motivated by a profound respect for the patient's worth and a desire to be faithful to the covenant of trust. The goals and virtues of medicine both command and constrain the conscientious physician. Thus, physicians are moved to act and to provide care because of their professional obligations, even if it sometimes puts them at considerable personal risk, as exemplified by the heroism of many Toronto physicians during the SARS epidemic and more recently in the Ebola epidemic in West Africa. Sometimes, however, and herein lies a critical observation, this same commitment to the goals and virtues of medicine may prevent us from acting. In other words, sometimes the physician's professional obligations require her to refuse a patient's request. This refusal may be gentle, kind, and accompanied by a sincere explanation, but refuse she must, or risk being unfaithful to her professional obligations as a physician. This analysis provides a basis for defining justifiable cases of conscientious objection. Objections offered by physicians without regard for the patient's interests or well-being seem very difficult to justify. Conscientious objections offered by physicians out of legitimate concern for the patient's interests and well-being seem salutary and even obligatory. The former kind of objection violates the goals and virtues of medicine. The latter kind of objection honors the goals and virtues of medicine. Thus, conscientious objection cannot necessarily be castigated as a case of self-interest. Without regard for the patient's welfare, such castigation attacks a straw man and misses the point. Conscientious objection, as I am defending it this evening, derives from the physician's professional obligations. It does not set aside those obligations. In fact, the claim that physicians can legitimately object to certain medical practices on the basis of obligation is unobjectionable. Even Shuklenk and Savalescu themselves accept this claim. They cite the case of a military nurse who refused to force feed patients in Guantanamo. The nurse's objection, they note, was justified on professional grounds. They wrote, quote, "Why do we applaud this conscientious objector but reject others who may hold as strong views about abortion as this nurse did about torture? It is trivially true that torture is not a medical practice which is in the interest of the patient or desired by the patient," close quote. They recognize that the nurse was justified in objecting to the demand to participate in torture because it ran contrary to her professional obligations. They draw a distinction, however, between objection to abortion and objection to participating in torture because in their view, the latter is self-evidently neither in the interest of the patient nor desired by the patient. This demand for torture was forced upon the nurse apart from the patient's will or concern for the patient's interests. Thus, objection was obligatory. So we've now made considerable progress in isolating the real issues at stake. The question is not whether doctors may offer conscientious objections in the light of their professional obligations, but rather whether it is possible for a patient's considered request for a legally available procedure to run counter to the professional obligations of physicians. Can doctors ever say no to patients if patients sincerely believe that the treatment that they request is in their best interest? Three basic categories of situations may arise where doctors feel compelled to say no to a patient's request. In the first category, doctor and patient share the same notion of interests and virtues, and the doctor believes that the patient is mistaken in believing that the requested intervention will advance those interests. This is by far the most common reason for that doctors feel compelled to decline to provide a requested therapy, and salient examples include declining to provide antibiotics for upper respiratory tract infections or surgery for non-operative cancer. In the second category, doctor and patient disagree about just what constitutes one's interests. And in the third category, the doctor may decline a patient's request on the view that it violates the virtues of medical practice. The latter two categories are by far more controversial than the first in that they are predicated on ethical claims rather than empirical claims. Nevertheless, certain admittedly unusual clinical scenarios intuitively suggest that it can be legitimate for physicians to refuse patient requests on the basis of ethical claims. Imagine, for example, that a patient presents to his physician seeking a prescription for medical marijuana. Upon questioning, he's found to be in good health and denies having any pain. He explains that he's currently bored and intends to use the marijuana purely for its euphoric effects. Now, there is no question that the prescription of marijuana can be efficacious for this purpose. So the grounds of refusal cannot be that it won't work. Nevertheless, we would expect the physician to decline this request because drug-induced euphoria is not an acceptable goal for medical practice. The College of Physicians, which has stipulated that doctors are required to refer patients to a willing physician in matters of conscientious objection, states that, quote, "As with any treatment, physicians are not obligated to prescribe dried marijuana if they do not believe it is clinically appropriate for their patient," close quote. Clinically appropriate is a loaded term pregnant with ethical as well as empirical concerns. Should doctors be referring the patient to a different physician who will prescribe the marijuana if they have an ethical objection to prescribing marijuana for this purpose? The college says no, because the members of the college hold the belief that providing prescription medications to achieve drug-induced euphoria is inconsistent with the goals and virtues of medicine. Thus, intuitively, it seems like physicians might be able to refuse a patient's request because they find that the proposed goal of therapy is not morally acceptable. Considering this admittedly unusual scenario suggests that patient requests may sometimes be refused purely on ethical grounds. Because medicine seeks particular goals, and must be practiced in accordance with particular virtues, doctors must sometimes conscientiously object. The all-pressing question is whether euthanasia might be reasonably considered to be a legitimate case for conscientious objection. So the question then is whether euthanasia is consistent with the goals and virtues of medicine. If so, then a physician ought to provide it. If no, then a physician ought not to provide it. This is the essence of the conflict that finds us here this evening. Proponents of euthanasia argue that it is consistent with the goals of medicine. They reason that if a patient faces grievous and irremediable suffering, it would be better to be dead than to remain alive to continue suffering. In his seminal work on the ethics of assisted death, philosopher Wayne Sumner writes, quote, "The harm of death lies in the value of life thereby foregone," close quote, and argues that, quote, "our moral status is not independent or logically prior to the prudential value of patients' lives. It is conditional on that value. Thus, if the patient does not value life, then death does not count as a harm. The physician is obligated to facilitate the patient's death because the patient weighs the consequences of living and dying and deems dying to be the superior condition for his well-being. Thus, euthanasia is held to be consistent with the goals of medicine." Opponents of euthanasia don't accept this line of reasoning. First, we don't accept the assumption that the value of life depends on the value placed upon it by the patient. Such an assumption raises serious concerns about the values of lives of many humans, including small children, who by virtue of their limited cognitive function have little or no ability to hold or express that value. Second, we would point out that attempts to calculate the benefit and harm of continued life face an insurmountable problem. We don't know what it's like to be dead. Viewing euthanasia as an effective treatment for suffering implicitly assumes that death is a state free of suffering, or at least less suffering. While we all certainly hope so, such claims are beyond the purview of medical science and necessarily constitute a kind of blind faith in death. Third, it seems strange to claim that one's health and well-being can be advanced by non-existence. How does one quantify the well-being or lack thereof attached to being dead? Fourth, high-quality palliative care can work wonders in terms of pain and symptom management, such that it is possible for dying patients to have a peaceful death without resorting to extinguishing their existence. An acceptable option of last resort is continuous terminal sedation, which I personally have provided to ensure that patients do not suffer in their final days and hours. Proponents of euthanasia in turn argue that it is consistent with the virtues of medicine to intentionally cause the patient's death. They hold that respect for patients' worth primarily manifests in respect for the patient's autonomous preferences, and that if the patient prefers to be dead, then that preference is to be honored. Opponents of euthanasia disagree. We hold that you cannot manifest respect for the patient's intrinsic and incalculable worth by extinguishing the patient. Certainly, we ought not to force the patient to undergo medical therapy, and we must invite the patient to share responsibility for medical decision-making regarding her health. But such respect for the patient's autonomy does not entail that we can treat the patient as a means to an end, as an object to destroy in order to advance the goals of medicine. This admittedly assumes that the patient's value inheres within the patient, irrespective of the patient's own opinion regarding the value of her life. Now, in reviewing these arguments pro and con around euthanasia, my aim is not to convince you one way or the other. Rather, I have two separate aims. First, I aim to point out that the conscientious objector's concerns are properly located in his desire to be faithful to the goals and virtues of medicine. This has nothing to do with self-interest or neglect of the patient's good. Rather, the objection has everything to do with a desire to manifest respect for the patient's worth and to be faithful to the covenant of trust with the patient. Given our view that euthanasia contravenes the goals and virtues of medicine, we are professionally obliged to object to it. Attacks upon conscientious objection based on claims that it is selfish and inconsistent with professional obligations are specious straw man arguments and need not merit further consideration. My second aim is to bring to light the fact that underlying the logic of these arguments, both pro and con, are profound assumptions about what is ultimately real and ultimately good. These assumptions, I will refer to them as foundational presuppositions, play an essential role in our interpretation of what it means to honor the patient's worth and to serve the patient's interests. We now turn to carefully consider the role played by the presuppositions, our presuppositions in medical ethics. Philosopher and bioethicist H. Tristram Engelhardt observes that, quote, "A characteristic feature of contemporary culture is that it is marked by persistent and foundational moral disputes." He continues, "Many of the parties to the disputes find themselves embedded in morally and metaphysically incongruent understandings of proper human deportment, the significance of human life, and the nature of human flourishing. This moral diversity will have divergent implications regarding end-of-life decision-making and the use of high-cost, low-yield medical interventions. On this view, behind the debate over euthanasia lie basic disagreements over fundamental questions about how one determines right and wrong, the meaning and purpose of human existence, the basis of human value, and the nature of life and death. I will refer to these beliefs as foundational presuppositions." 19th century philosophers such as Kant and Hegel referred to one's view on these foundational presuppositions as Weltanschauung, or worldviews. A worldview may be defined as a commitment, a fundamental orientation of the heart, that can be expressed in a story or in a set of presuppositions, which are assumptions which may be true, partially true, or entirely false, which we hold, consciously or subconsciously, consistently or inconsistently, about the basic construction of reality, and that provides the foundation in which we live and move and have our being. The influence of worldview on ethical beliefs is unavoidable. It is impossible to escape the influence of our basic view of reality on our moral beliefs and consequently on our actions and policies. To show how this is so, consider contemporary secular bioethics. Is secular bioethics influenced by presuppositions about reality? Many seem to think no. In fact, they suggest that one ought to adhere to the deliverances of secular ethics in order to arrive at a properly neutral and minimally biased ethical system in a pluralistic society. Thus, an eminent group of Canadian moral philosophers writing in the Royal Society's report on end-of-life care decision-making in Canada reject appeals to theological beliefs about the creation of humans in the image of God as a basis for rejecting euthanasia. They write that the underlying premise, namely that all humans are possessed of dignity in virtue of a special relationship to God, to a God, is, however, incapable of being used as a basis of public policy in the context of a democratic, multicultural, and multi-faith society that must cleave to the strictures of public reason and ethical deliberation. In the absence of a societal consensus in favor of, or incontrovertible proof of the existence of the God in question, this account of human dignity cannot be relied upon to justify normative guidance on assisted dying on a societal level. As we saw earlier, this same argument is used as a basis for rejecting the religious beliefs of individual physicians as grounds for objection. Physicians, it said, as professionals, must cleave to the strictures of public reason and provide secular grounds for their objection. Thus, theological claims are regarded as biased, whereas the secular perspective is held to be the default position of neutrality best suited for the pluralistic context of our society. In fact, if neutrality implies that one does not start with any unargued assumptions about the world, or that one starts only with assumptions held in common by all, then the secular standpoint is most certainly not neutral. Let us consider a number of foundational beliefs presupposed by secular ethics. Although I recognize that secular ethics is anything but monolithic, dominant contemporary ethical systems generally rely on the following foundational beliefs. First, the secular standpoint assumes without argument that the preferences of patients ought to be respected. There aren't very many deep prohibitions in secular bioethics, but probably the most significant is the prohibition on violating patient autonomy. Yet secular ethicists make no effort to give an account of why human autonomy merits respect. This is simply a basic starting point for moral conversation for the secular ethicist. If one asks why one ought to respect patient autonomy, no answer is given. It is held to be self-evident, and thus no argument is thought to be necessary. A second related assumption is that the patient's preferences are a necessary and sufficient condition for valuing the patient herself. Yet using human preference as a foundation for human value presumes that if we want something, we ought to have it. It's not clear how this basis for human value could withstand the simple query, why should we care what you want? My point here is that not that we don't need to care about preferences, rather I'm simply pointing out that this basis for human value is simply assumed without reason or evidence. Another related assumption is the belief that human well-being matters. This is simply taken for granted without reason or evidence. Some try to locate the value of well-being in the fact of well-being. Wayne Sumner writes that, quote, our moral status is dependent on the fact that we have lives that can go well or badly for us, close quote. But this seems to me to be a very good example of the fact-value fallacy identified by the Scottish skeptic David Hume. Just because we have the capacity for pain and pleasure, or sadness and happiness, doesn't necessarily entail that we ought to have pleasure or happiness. This assumes again that because one has the potential to have something, one ought to have something. And it's not at all obvious that this is true. Fourth, the secular standpoint assumes without argument that it is within our powers to reliably judge the effect of different interventions on our well-being. This is one of the basic tenets of consequentialism, which dominates contemporary secular ethics. Consequentialism assumes that we can make reasonably accurate predictions in light of moral decisions, and more importantly, it also assumes that it's possible for us to know ourselves what is good for us. Indeed, in some quarters, there seems to be an assumption that well-being can be defined by autonomy. In other words, something is good for us merely if we say that it is so. Fifth, as argued above, secular ethics seems to make tacit assumptions about the nature of life after death. Consider the claim that a patient may decide that it is in his interest no longer to be alive. This necessarily presupposes some knowledge of what it's like to be dead. Yet medicine has no empirical observational knowledge of what it's like to be dead. There may or may not be an afterlife, but doctors can't speak with any authority on this issue. Rather, we're presupposing that there is no afterlife, or that the afterlife is better than present conditions, when we say that we can help the patient by ending their life. I'm not listing these assumptions of the secular standpoint because I think these beliefs are entirely or necessarily false. In fact, I share some of these beliefs. Rather, I wish to point out that the secular standpoint on ethics is not neutral. It carries its own philosophical baggage, and its view of ethical questions is colored by its foundational presuppositions about what is ultimately real and what is ultimately good. These philosophical claims are made without supplying argument or evidence. This becomes especially obvious if we apply to these claims the same standard of proof frequently required of religious belief. The Royal Society stipulated that, quote, incontrovertible proof must be provided in favor of belief in God in order to permit theological beliefs to influence moral decision-making. Yet no incontrovertible proof is supplied in favor of the secular presuppositions listed here. Tristram Engelhardt writes that, quote, the ideology of autonomy and equality, even if it were to reflect the morality that all did in fact embrace, cannot be shown by rational argument to be the morality that all should embrace. There is no independent perspective from which this moral perspective could in principle be justified. In this sense, the secular standpoint seems to function merely as another kind of religious belief. Philosopher John Reeder points out that if one defines religion simply as accepting some concept of the real in search for the good, then people who are often said to be non-religious or secular should instead be said to have an alternative religion. Philosopher and ethicist Loris Culligan writes, in the context of ethics, it is inappropriate to draw a line between one set of beliefs labeled religious and another set labeled philosophical because in doing so, one fails to appreciate that beliefs under either of these labels serve similarly foundational roles in ethical reasoning. In pointing out these issues, I am not claiming that secular ethics necessarily supports a particular position on euthanasia. Objections can be raised against euthanasia on secular grounds. Nor am I arguing that there are no moral truths or that any set of presuppositions may be as true as any other. The problem is not one of moral epistemology, it is a problem of moral epistemology. What I want us to see is that the influence of our foundational presuppositions on our ethics is inescapable, a fact that applies to the secular standpoint as much as it does to any theological perspective. There is therefore no reason to assume that we should by default accept a secular standpoint. It is unreasonable and inconsistent to expect religious physicians to exclude their foundational beliefs about ultimate reality and ultimate good from influencing their interpretation of medicine's basic values if secular physicians and ethicists are unwilling and unable to do the same. In the face of such diversity of foundational moral belief systems, how do we proceed to resolve matters of conflict in medical ethics? Two options present themselves. First, we may employ force to coerce one party to accept the views of the others. Yet in the absence of a universally accepted moral standard because of differing foundational presuppositions, no moral justification can be given for coercion. Coercion in this context is merely an act of will to power. Alternatively, we may employ an approach based on mutual consent. Far too often in the history of medicine, the coercive approach has been employed in favor of the physician. Much has been accomplished to remedy this. Respect for patient autonomy is now recognized as a core principle of medical ethics, and shared decision-making models of medical care are now widely employed. Yet in the medical covenant, there is a second party, the physician. In entering into covenant with the patient, the physician offers to help the patient. This offer and this promise are necessarily conditioned on the physician understanding of what constitutes help and harm in accordance with his foundational presuppositions. In making this offer of help, the physician does not offer to act as if the patient's foundational presuppositions are true. The medical covenant entails that both patient and physician share a particular view of benefit and harm. Only once the physician has promised to provide the kind of help requested by the patient can the patient make any claim on the physician's behavior. Engelhardt observes that given the lack of a universally accepted foundation for ethics, a particular moral community will only have that authority that the individuals who constitute it grant to it, insofar as one will wish to speak of secular moral authority. One will have to respect the freedom of each individual as a condition for the possibility of that general community's moral authority. In other words, professional obligations deriving from the patient-physician covenant do not carry any force if mutual consent is lacking. The vision of patient autonomy presented by the opponents of conscientious objection would coerce the physician to be subject to the patient's foundational beliefs simply by virtue of the fact that she offers to help the sick. Edmund Pellegrino observed that patient autonomy is becoming absolutized to the extent that the right to refuse treatment has become the right to demand treatment. There's now need to be concerned about violations of the physician's autonomy, that is to protect the integrity of the physician's values as a person and a moral being, and to protect the integrity of the enterprise of medical ethics itself. In the covenantal relationship between physician and patient, two persons equally possessed of intrinsic value and autonomous moral agency come together in a shared mission to advance the patient's health and well-being. The physician offers her skill and expertise in order to do good for the patient. In doing so, her notion of good is influenced by the patient's goals and priorities, but is not subjugated to the patient's personal moral beliefs. The patient is no more likely than the physician to be correct in his personal moral beliefs. Indeed, such conflicts require an attitude of moral epistemic humility, the tacit admission that either party could be right. Consequently, when the patient and the physician disagree on the nature of health and well-being, the principle of respect for autonomy, deriving from medicine's aim to respect the intrinsic worth of human persons, applies equally to physician and patient. Accordingly, just as a physician ought not to be forced to act against his personal moral beliefs, the physician ought not to be forced to act against hers. The physician's moral convictions, which move her to care for the patient in the first place, cannot be jettisoned once the clinical counter proceeds. We come now to the conclusion. I'm almost done. We're considering challenging and painful issues. The fragmented and pluralistic morality of our society makes life together challenging. However, I believe that the political virtues of Canadian society, which we adopt by mutual consent, freedom, respect, and tolerance, make it possible to coexist peacefully, if not in absolute harmony. I wish to close by presenting several practical implications of my analysis for the issues of conscientious objection. First, a recognition of the role that presupposed foundational beliefs and values play in all our thought and action leads us to a renewed spirit of mutual respect and tolerance. For example, I sincerely believe that my colleagues who support euthanasia are sincerely trying to do good for their patients. In light of their foundational beliefs, they genuinely and sincerely believe that sometimes it is a good thing to end the patient's life. If they did not believe that it was good, they would not do it. The problem, in my view, lies not in their intentions, but in their presuppositions. I disagree with the way they see the world and human meaning and value. And this foundational disagreement leads us to disagree about whether or not euthanasia is morally acceptable. Meaningful ethical conversation must therefore focus on the real point of tension. And this approach has allowed my relationship with colleagues of differing opinions to flourish and develop in the face of our open and frank disagreement. A recognition of the role of foundational beliefs motivates us to exhibit the virtue of epistemic humility. Epistemic humility leads us to admit that our position engages certain unargued assumptions, and it keeps us from coercing others to act as if our own foundational beliefs are true. So I ask my secular colleagues and those physicians in positions of governing authority to exercise a spirit of respect and tolerance arising from epistemic humility. I ask them to carefully consider the unargued and presupposed character of their foundational beliefs. I ask them to reconsider the apparent assumption that medicine is an innately secular activity to be governed by secular assumptions and secular faith commitments. I ask them to appreciate that the fact that conscientious objectors are acting out of sincere concern for the welfare of the patient and a desire to practice medicine consistent with the virtues of medicine. Second, these considerations lead us to recognize that the responsibility to ensure access to euthanasia or similarly controverted treatments falls on those who believe that it is a good thing to provide. The duty to provide access is necessarily predicated on the claim that the proposed intervention is good. There are many potential therapies to which Canadians do not have access, and this is because the medical community considers such therapies harmful, or at least non-beneficial. The recent controversy over access to venoplasty for chronic cerebrospinal venous insufficiency and multiple sclerosis provides a salient example. Access to a given intervention is not primarily determined by respect for patient autonomy, but rather by the medical community's beliefs about benefit. Now, granted, many Canadian physicians believe that euthanasia is beneficial. The question is whether some physicians who oppose euthanasia have a duty to provide access because other physicians support euthanasia. I argue that insofar as making an effective referral for euthanasia as a physician engages one's professional obligations and makes one complicit in the act of euthanasia, our commitment to be faithful to the medical covenant and the goals and virtues of medicine requires us to decline to make any such referral. Unless our foundational presuppositions can be shown to be less worthy of acceptance than the foundational beliefs of those who support euthanasia, our consciences are justified in declining to make a referral. So I say to those who would require us to make an effective referral, unless you can prove by reason and evidence that your foundational beliefs are true, how can you seek to coerce us to violate our professional obligations to care for the patient? Such coercion constitutes a severe violation of the political liberties granted by the Canadian Constitution, and it finds no support in the obligations of the covenant between patient and physician, since the very character of these obligations depends on one's foundational presuppositions. Those who, in light of their foundational presuppositions, sincerely believe that euthanasia is good for patients must take up the responsibility of facilitating access. Organizations such as Dying with Dignity that have lobbied for decades to achieve legalization can find continued meaning and purpose in helping patients to find a willing physician. If the state decides that it has an interest in facilitating access, then it can readily find ways to do so. Indeed, most provinces in Canada have found ways to facilitate access. Conscientious objection to referral may sometimes constitute a minor inconvenience for patients. The truth is, our healthcare system tolerates far greater inconveniences to patients for a range of significant health issues. Patients are forced to wait long hours in emergency departments, months on surgical waiting lists, and sometimes are required to travel and move because of the way in which specialized care is regionalized. These sometimes necessary inconveniences are far more grievous than any potentially resulting from conscientious objection to euthanasia. Thirdly, implications for institutional objection. The issue of institutional objection is especially controversial at present. Many assume that hospitals and other institutions that receive state funding have a responsibility to ensure access to euthanasia by virtue of the fact that they receive taxpayer dollars. They argue that objecting institutions should be coerced to provide access, possibly by the threat of defunding. This argument fails to take account of several important considerations. First, institutions are not impersonal entities. They express core values, commitments, and goals. Institutions express beliefs and adhere to foundational presuppositions. This is especially true of any institution that provides healthcare. Just as physicians have moral obligations that derive from the value of the patient, so institutions have moral obligations that derive from the value of the patient. Groups of individuals are just as morally accountable to patients as individuals are. Second, we must ask whether institutions ought to default to the secular standpoint. Given the challenges of adjudicating foundational presuppositions as summarized above, I don't see any good reason why this ought to be the case. Should taxpayer-funded institutions default to the secular standpoint? This would be the case only if the government was morally obliged to support the secular standpoint over and against any other foundational belief system. Yet given the religious character of secular presuppositions, such a commitment to the secular standpoint on the part of the government would constitute a troubling violation of separation between church and state. This form of state commitment to secular presuppositions is very different than the traditional liberal notion of the secular state as the neutral party committed to freedom for all individuals to live in accordance with their foundational beliefs. Finally, I want to emphasize the implications of our analysis for the relationship between patient and physician. The patient and the physician enter into a covenant of care by their mutual consent. It is their mutual consent that gives force to the obligations of the medical covenant. Both patient and physician bring foundational presuppositions to this relationship, and these beliefs will influence their respective views of benefit and harm. With respect to foundational beliefs, the physician has no special expertise as a professional, and the physician's foundational beliefs carry no more weight than those of the patient. Thus, patient and physician stand side by side as equals in these matters, and physicians must display the virtue of epistemic humility toward their patients. This entails that when the doctor declines a patient's request because of conflicting foundational beliefs, the doctor is obliged to do so humbly and respectfully, not harshly or impatiently or judgmentally. The conscientious objector manifests epistemic humility by being prepared to discuss the patient's request, by exploring their reasons for seeking the requested intervention, and by answering the patient's questions to the best of their ability. We have no authority as physicians to call into question the patient's foundational beliefs, only to explain that we have differing foundational beliefs that compel us to believe that the requested intervention is harmful rather than beneficial. We must make clear our unwavering commitment to care for the patient. We must make clear that their decision to seek the requested intervention elsewhere will not affect the quality of medical care that we will continue to provide to them in any way. We must devote ourselves to treating pain, dyspnea, and other dreaded symptoms at the end of life with skill, patience, compassion, and diligence. Finally, we must manifest respect for the patient as an autonomous moral agent by disclosing the influence of our foundational convictions on these contested issues in medicine to the patient in advance of any request before entering into covenant with them. Indeed, I think all patients have the right to know how their physician's foundational presuppositions might influence their medical recommendations. I can with confidence guarantee that my colleagues who conscientiously object to euthanasia would strongly echo these sentiments. This evening, I have undertaken to defend the thesis that the professional obligations of medicine actually require physicians to object when they believe that the requested intervention is not in the patient's best interests, or that performing the requested intervention would contravene medicine's respect for the incalculable intrinsic worth of the patient. I have argued that our foundational presuppositions play a critical and inescapable role in arriving at such judgments, and that there is no good reason to default to the secular standpoint in making such assessments. I conclude that conscientious objection to euthanasia is justifiable. The invitation to give this lecture has occasioned a great deal of soul searching on my part in an effort to reconcile theory and practice. I am left with a renewed sense of gratitude for the profound privilege of caring for the patient and a renewed desire to conscientiously pursue the goals of my profession in accordance with virtue and in a spirit of epistemic humility. I thank you for your attention.